Good evening, everybody. Just want to check. You can hear us in the back row up there. Our microphones are working fine. Good, lots of waves. I'm Nicholas Reece. I'm a principal fellow here at the University of Melbourne, and it's my honour to be your moderator this evening. Now, as you all know, this Saturday, Australians will vote in the 45th federal election we have had since 1901. Elections are always important, and this one particularly so. Australia's a country, we find ourselves at the proverbial crossroads with huge challenges and opportunities confronting our country. Whoever wins on Saturday, they'll find themselves facing some very big decisions over the 3 years ahead. To help make sense of the election campaign and the issues in the election, Election Watch and the Melbourne School of Government have gathered together a panel of top journalists, political experts, and political scientists. The panel will discuss key election issues, the anticipated outcomes, and we're going to answer your burning questions as well. So get ready for that. To introduce the panel, at the end there we have Dr. Andrea Carson, who is a lecturer in media and politics at the University of Melbourne. She's also an honorary fellow at the University Centre for Advancing Journalism. Her research interests include the relationship between news media and democracy, the role of investigative journalism, digital media and political communication. Please make Andrea welcome. Next to Andrea, we have Ellen Whinnett, who is a journalist of more than 20 years' experience and is now the national political editor of the Herald Sun. She's also worked as the deputy editor of the Sunday Herald Sun. She's won numerous journalism awards, including a Walkley Award for her news reporting. Please make Ellen welcome tonight. Our next guest, where to start? Barrie Cassidy. He's one of Australia's most experienced political journalists, having covered federal politics since the late 1970s. From 1986 to 91, he was, of course, a senior press secretary and political advisor to Labor Prime Minister Bob Hawke. He's worked as a political correspondent for numerous ABC programs, and he currently hosts the record-breaking Sunday morning political discussion program, Insiders. Please make Barrie welcome. Next to Barrie, we have Peta Credlin, who is a Sky News specialist commentator, along with myself, and also a News Limited columnist. Peta has a distinguished career as a political advisor, having started her work in 1999 as an advisor to Liberal Senator Kay Patterson. Since then, she's held various roles, including an advisor to Senator Richard Alston, an executive with Racing Victoria, and a political staffer for Senators Robert Hill and Helen Coonan, and of course, Malcolm Turnbull. She also served as Tony Abbott's chief of staff from 2009 until 2015. Please make Peta welcome. And finally, beside me is someone who I know very well, and that's Ben Hubbard, the General Manager of Public Policy and Strategy at Maurice Blackburn Lawyers. Ben has a distinguished career as a political advisor and senior public servant. He served as Chief of Staff to Australia's former Prime Minister, Julia Gillard. Prior to that, he was appointed Chief Executive of the Victorian Bushfire Reconstruction and Recovery Authority, and he also served as Principal Advisor to the Victorian Premier, Steve Brax. Please make Ben welcome. So just a little bit of housekeeping before we get into it. I should let you know that this event is being filmed and it's also being live streamed, as is the way these days. I believe you can view the live stream on the Election Watch website. You can also participate in the event online. You can do that through the Twitter hashtag ElectionWatch and through the Election Watch Facebook page. And Kathy and Molly, do you want to put your hands up? So later in the evening when we get into Q&A, we'll be taking some questions on Facebook and on Twitter, and they will be picking questions to put to our panellists. And we also have Heath and Erin in the audience. Do you want to show yourselves now? And later on when we get to questions, they will have the roving mics and come and see you. So the plan is we'll have about a 45-minute discussion to start with the panel, and then we'll go to questions for about 45 minutes. Obviously, we want to make it a lively event, but it's also going to be a polite event as well. No question is too hard, but there are questions which I will judge to be too rude, so make them hard, but keep yourselves nice is the basic mode of operation for this evening. So let's get into it, guys. The 2016 election campaign, you've all seen a lot of election campaigns from inside and out. What are your impressions about the 2016 campaign? Barrie, I might start with you on that one. You've seen a few election campaigns.
Yeah, I saw some interesting figures today on the Crikey website that said talked about media mentions. And the interesting thing was that in the 2013 election, Abbott and Rudd had more media mentions than Turnbull and in 5 weeks than Turnbull and Shorten have had in 8 weeks. I think that's a reflection of the disengagement. Both leaders are a little lacklusty. You only get one Tony Abbott in a lifetime, but I think that because of that, they have been, I think both of them, quite efficient and effective to a point. But there has been a level of disengagement. I think that's partly because right from the outset, most people, and the polls have shown this consistently, most people thought that the coalition government would be returned. And I think they still believe that.
Hmm. Ben, you've also run many state and federal campaigns. What's your view of the 2016 federal campaign?
I am partial to a bit of alliteration, so I'm going with long, laborious and lumpy. The amount of time, you know, the 8 weeks, it's pretty extraordinary. There's good sort of constitutional mechanical reasons why it was 8 weeks, but 8 weeks in winter with an electorate that's using different media, different consumption habits. So I was telling someone just off stage earlier about how, you know, we've got young children. So I don't watch commercial TV. We get ABC for kids and I watch stuff on Catch Up and iView. So whether it's my habits or the electorate's habits about where they get information, I think the rules are changing slowly, so that even a comparison to last election needs to be put in the context of how people consume media and where they get their information from. The campaign itself, you know, I like to watch where leaders go and the activities they do. And, you know, there's been some interesting presentations of activity. I think what I've watched with interest is the thematics, how they've moved in and out of particular thematics. So Medicare's been a late thematic, whereas taxation has been at a different time, or border security and refugees is a different time. So 8 weeks you've seen thematics come in and out. So it's been a different election, but maybe that's not so much about the dates, but maybe the evolution of the electorate and media consumption.
Thanks, Ben. Peta, you're considered one of the best campaign operators in the country. What's your take on this campaign?
Well, I think there's three campaigns, and there's the national campaign, which I think everyone in this room is buying into. There's the local campaign that comes through your mailbox, if you're in the suburbs, when you go to the local supermarket. To some degree, it's coming at you at social media. It depends what medium you're on. And then there's the campaign ground war, which Ben and I would have been engaged in, which is the seat-by-seat battle run out of the campaign headquarters. In our case, that's Canberra. In Labor's case, that's Melbourne. And that is where the strategy for the campaign is run from. So you'll have the leader on the road, and yes, there's a lot that you can garner watching the other side, where they move, the key messages, the design of their day, how early they start, the mix of media that they get across. Noticed this week there are some cases of the Prime Minister being, say, in South Australia, but diving into radio broadcasts up and down the Central Coast, which tells you there's late movements, positive or negative, in some of those markets. So you watch that ground game played out through the leader, but it's really driven out of a very centralised campaign headquarters, not dissimilar to campaign headquarters around the world for the Republicans, for the Democrats, for the Tories and for Labor in Britain. And that team runs the strategy. And what we're seeing right now in the late mail coming into Saturday is the end result of where that strategy has started, midpoint of the campaign, and where it's landing to with the last couple of days. We lose electronic media tonight. I have to say, I think it's fairly antiquated these days in any event, particularly with a high rate of pre-polls. People have polled in the middle of the media, and now we go into this so-called blackout. But anyway, you go into the blackout, and then we really are at the last push in the next 2 days.
Thanks. Ellen, any opening observations about this election campaign?
Yeah, sure. I think what we're seeing is that a 55-day campaign is really different to a 33-day campaign. And one really obvious way I think that's manifested itself is all of the disasters in the early days of the campaign have virtually been forgotten. So when David Feeney forgot to declare his house, that was a big story, and everyone went nuts about it for 3 days, and I doubt anyone's thought about it for the last 3 weeks. When Labor was going through their pains with the breakouts on asylum seeker policy, and campaign headquarters was trying to manage that, one of the things that someone in campaign headquarters said to me was, at least we got it out of the way in the first week, and we can move on from it. So I think in the shorter campaigns, when you have something that goes wrong, there's much less time to recover from that. Whereas I think they would be looking at this now and saying, well, they're out of the way. If we can just get through to the end, hopefully people will have forgotten about some of those problems we had early on.
Things move fast in election campaign, don't they? Last week was a year ago, it would seem. Andrew is a political scientist. Any opening observations?
Yeah, well, I concur with most of the comments that have already been said. I think it's a marathon and not a sprint. And in terms of fragmentation, Peta made the point that we've been seeing three different types of campaigns going on. I tend to look at politics through the lens of the media, and I would say that there's been great fragmentation of audience, probably more so than what we've seen before, with social media being used more and more for political communication, for politicians identifying that it's a fast and cheap way to be able to get a message out and to get those hard-to-reach voters that have been difficult to get perhaps in the past, people that are happy to chat about politics in a non-conventional sense on Facebook and be able to reach them through third party groups, perhaps politicians signing up to a charity that you might follow on Facebook and getting their messages through that way. Traditional media, I think, has been much more fragmented too. You've got to remember that this campaign started on May the 8th. May the 9th, Fairfax announced more job losses and they were forced redundancies. And then on top of that, we haven't seen quite the rabid campaign that we have seen in the past with News Corp doing those front pages that we saw in previous elections, such as kick this mob out or does this guy ever shut up? We've had Bilnocchio, but not quite to the same level.
Thanks, Andrea. Interesting your reference to social media and how that's sort of changing the way campaigns are run. Barrie, I guess starting with you, when you were following election campaigns as an aide to the Prime Minister in the 1980s and now as a seasoned observer of elections since, how do you think election campaigning has changed over the last two or three decades?
Not massively. In 1987, we didn't have mobile phones. We carried this brick around with us in 1990, but in 1987, we had to go into principal's offices and the matron's office and just commandeer a telephone when you're on the road. The coordination was just so difficult. And of course, there was no social media. And what the mistakes that were made back then is that we drove the leaders to exhaustion. They would wake up to a whole string of radio commitments. They would do two or three events through the day, at least one doorstop, and then they'd be doing fundraisers at night and then go to bed exhausted. And so that kind of thing was just crazy, and that had to change. And now everything is just so well targeted these days to the point where the whole strategy really is built around a single doorstop. And they're more managed than ever. Back in the 80s, the media would get the full week laid out, which, in retrospect, was really? it didn't give you much flexibility. But yeah, they would know from Monday to Friday where they would be.
What city?
Wow. And then if you made a change, of course, that became a big deal. Why are they doing that? Well, that's clearly because they're getting belted in South Australia. And it led to that kind of, and quite rightly, to that sort of analysis. So we gave the media a lot of information. You might say it's a good thing, but it disadvantaged the politicians. And now it's, I just think the control is excessive, so that you can get in a bus now, get out of your hotel into a bus and not know where you're going, or you can head off to the airport not knowing what city you might be headed for. And the door stops, and Malcolm Turnbull is particularly adept at this, is that he'll take five questions and there are no follow-ups on any questions, so you can give the answer that you want to give and that's it. Just the other day, he was asked about the plebiscite, and he said, "Oh, haven't we got any more questions on the economy? Anyone got another question on the economy?" So he got another one on that, and never did get back to the plebiscite. And so you can kind of control things, I think, a whole lot more efficiently than happened in the 80s.
Peter, you led the travelling party for the 2013 election and the 2010 election. Now, yeah. I reflect on it. Tell us, what's your reflections on the sort of modern election campaign?
I think the 2010 campaign was unusual in the sense that both leaders, the Prime Minister then Julia Gillard, hadn't had the job very long, and Tony Abbott was, in December 2009, the third leader, fourth if you count John Howard, that we'd had in 2.5 years. So we didn't know what we didn't know, and a lot of time was spent from December up until when the campaign was called. I thought that they would come back from Copenhagen and pull a double D in the February. So we spent most of that summer holed up, treating it like SWAT back, dragging everything together, ready to go. And then obviously from that February, the longer we had, the more time we had to prepare. And I think that was a very interesting contest because both parties and both leaders were at the same position in terms of getting the travelling party organised. And I'll go back to Barrie's point. I mean, You don't notice this so much in the real world, sitting back here now looking at the campaign, but each political office of 40-odd staff is responsible for the logistics of the Prime Minister and the jet and 50 people, and also a travelling campaign of media, in our case in 2010, 2013. That was 30 media sometimes. Sometimes it was 80. You have to physically move their bags and them and buses and hotel rooms. We had one time in the 2013 campaign where we slept in the same hotel bed two nights in a row. Other than that, you're literally moving the logistics of this massive machine without letting anybody know where you're going, because everyone will overanalyse the seat you've gone to or the announcement you've made. So the logistics are enormous. They're not done by anybody other than political staff. So you are losing brain power from your travelling team to put them in bag schlepping and plain organisational jobs, but that's the only way you can do it. So you've got this massive movement of the leader, and at the same time, that leader has to be completely plugged in with campaign headquarters. And Ben can probably talk about the real Julia moment and the disconnect that happened in 2010. We've had plenty of those too, but if the travelling party, the Prime Minister, isn't connected with headquarters, you'll get away with that for a couple of weeks, but you will not get away with that for the campaign, and that's when the show really comes off the road, usually in spectacular fashion. That's fascinating to watch. And to be fair, both sides, there's been no indication of that this time around.
Thanks, Peter. Ben, you're known as a bit of a guru, well, were known as a bit of a guru in the Labor Party for putting together the 35-day grid or the 28-day grid. So that's in a four-week or five-week election campaign where every day is painstakingly mapped out and planned out. Tell us, how would you put something together like that, and you know, what are you thinking?
Yeah, I'll just close off on Peter. I was off building bushfire devastated communities when Real Julia happened, and I thought it was curious, but I don't have any explanation. But notwithstanding that, maybe a reflection on 2007 when I was first time around in Canberra looking after IR when I worked for Julia when she was deputy leader. But you want to build a grid which is well structured and thematic and thoughtful and prepared, but you want to maintain maximum flexibility where you know themes are going well and places are important. So people think back to 2007. It was an IR election. It was work choices was the issue du jour for that campaign. So every morning, literally, Kevin's crew would ring me up at 5:30 a.m. and said, "Mate, we've just done the hookup. We want to do IR today." Okay. And so you'd, because I was the chief of staff and then shadow IR minister, you'd have stuff ready to roll. And that's about maintaining tactical flexibility, and people knew that was a really significant issue. It was resonating, and to maximise the opportunities to talk about IR and work choices. More generally, it is harder in a national campaign to have that flexibility because of the logistics Peta talked about. State campaigns are a lot easier because you're just hubbing out of a capital city, and you know, in Victoria, everything's either a short plane ride or a couple of hours in the car. So you can do it a lot better in Victoria. The challenge, of course, is to have something to say. So you've got to do the policy work as well. It's not just the mechanics and the comms prep, but it's also, you actually got to have a policy agenda that's cohesive and costed, where you can bring things off the shelf to do that day. You can't just get out there and make stuff up. Yeah. It may seem like that occasionally, but in terms of a serious party and a serious campaign, it has been thought through, it has been costed, and has been prepared.
Yeah. Can I just add something on that point,
sure,
though? This is one thing people don't appreciate sometimes, is the connection. So the leader generally, Prime Minister, Leader of the Opposition, every night will cover off on the policy announcements. So they'll be clearing costings. Yes, a team has put them together, but they'll actually physically, leaders I've worked with, go through the document. They'll want to know what's being launched the next day in detail. And sometimes that can run till midnight, closing off documents that you'll need either a couple of days down the track or that next immediate day.
Yeah, it's a never, never stops, does it? Turning to the media and this election campaign, I'd be interested to hear your views, Andrea and Ellen. You know, what is your assessment about the quality of political reportage in this campaign? And, you know, we often hear that the quality of political reporting is declining. Do you agree with that thesis? Tell us what you think, Andrea.
No, I don't agree with that thesis. I'm more inclined to go for the fragmentation, so that I think we get very comfortable with the kind of media we're used to consuming, and we stay within that bubble, and we don't necessarily look at media that we're not as familiar with. But if we step back and look at everything that's available through the mainstream media and through social media, I think there's actually more attention to policy than there has been in the past. I think there's more information than there has been in the past. I think journalists are also very adept at, we've just heard about how professionalised campaigns are, and there's a pushback against that. And we see that in various ways. One is through political polling. That's a way for newspapers, which long ago lost the competition on breaking news and also on dissemination to digital media. One way they can get back that agenda is to do the political poll, to sponsor those polls. They get the information first, they can build the story around it. Another way we see the pushback against the professionalisation of the campaign is the gotcha moment, which I think is maybe not the best use of the media's time. And we've seen a little bit of that in this campaign with the gotcha moment against Julie Bishop and another one against Sarah Hanson-Young. And Alan mentioned the one with David Feeney. He's had a few. And the other way is to pull back the lens, and we'll get to see during a press scrum, the cameraman will show the press scrum, show the audience that this is a construction. This isn't a mirror of life. Whereas back in the day on the bus, there was this famous clip of John Howard. He flipped a coin. He was on the Tasmanian Oval, the cricket club there. And he flipped a coin to do the toss, and Alan Border shook his hand. It was a wonderful moment. But you scan around, and this was a documentary that was made at the time, there was no one in the stand bar maybe three people, and they weren't eligible to vote because they were kids. But the next day, the front page coverage, it looked fantastic. It looked like John Howard and Alan Border were besties, and that he knew everything there was to know about sport. So I think as an audience, we get to see a little bit more of that, of how these campaigns are constructed. So I'm not one to go on that easy to say side of the media's not doing a very good job anymore. I think it's there if we look for it.
And Alan, you're there on the front line doing it, obviously as a very senior reporter. What's your take on the state of political reporting?
Well, I don't agree with everything Andrea said in terms of newspapers giving up the breaking news to digital, because we do it on our digital platforms.
Except the polls.
Sure, but we break our polls in the newspapers. So, you know, you'll see polls this week that will be tweeted out at 10 o'clock at night and be on the front pages where you can go through it, pages and pages of it with all the graphs. You're going to get that in the newspapers the next day. I think with broadcast journalism, what you get to see is the journalism being made. So when you're reading a paper, you're seeing the end result. But when you're seeing the broadcast journalism, so like Neil Mitchell's interview with Julie Bishop, you're actually... That was a really forensic interview where he just pulled apart the fact that she didn't know the answers on the superannuation policy, which was really problematic for them. And if anyone saw what was going on at the National Press Club yesterday, the journos really pulled apart Bill Shorten on taking a quote and taking it too far as to what he could use it for. He was using it in the context of criticising Malcolm Turnbull for not being honest, but in fact he wasn't 100% honest himself in terms of using this quote. And if you watch the vision of it, you will see the journos just one after the other pulling that apart, and Sabra Lane just finished him off with it. And where I do agree with Andrea is that I think the journalists are still doing that work. I know what we're doing day in and day out. Certainly our company has two reporters on each bus. We don't have our bureau chiefs or our political editors on the bus because there are 40 people there and you cannot have a conversation on the phone that other people aren't hearing. So the political editors and people who are tasked with finding exclusive stories are all back in their offices or doing day trips, which is how we've been doing it. So we are trying to cover the policies and the announcements. I know there's been a little bit of collaboration going on with the journos when the leaders are avoiding a question. The journos have caucused it a bit and said, I know he's not going to answer it, so I'm going to come in and have another go at it. But when you've got a lot of organisations there, you're trying to feed radio, TV, often their journos standing there reading out the question that the seniors in Canberra have asked them to ask. And so that can be where you get the very quick, this question, onto the next, because you're trying to get those grabs up at night. All of the journos are trying to get a little piece of them for their stories at night or their next radio bulletin.
Thanks. And Barrie, I mean, you've seen both sides of it. You've sort of been a chief spin doctor for a prime minister and as distinguished journalist. How do you judge political reporting today, and what, you know, is it heading in the right direction?
I think probably the journalists and the politicians are both getting better at it. The politicians are getting better at just targeting the message and getting it out there and setting their own agendas. The journalists are doing the best they can within that constraint. I think the journalists who spend a bit of time on the road but sensibly spend a lot of time back in Canberra so that they're not just constantly on the move, as Peter suggested, when you become part of that circus, you lose a lot of time. And so the best approach for the more senior journalists is to get in Canberra, get the transcripts and work the phones and get their own stories, but go on the road occasionally and get a feel for it. I think through this campaign, Phil Currie from the Fin Review, I think David Crowe from the Australian have had excellent campaigns. But I think Sarah Ferguson took it to a new level on Four Corners. I thought that was just riveting television. And there were no sides, no prisoners. that was journalism at its best. And I think anyone that was frustrated to that point about whether the media was doing its job or not, you watch that and surely you would think, well, at least somebody broke through.
Peter and Ben, I'm interested to get your thoughts on managing the media pack. I mean, is it getting harder for politicians to get beyond that, you know, daily 24-hour news churn to talk about policy? How do you manage the pack?
Let me bounce off Barrie. I'd sort of had a pretty low opinion until about a week ago. I saw Four Corners and I thought Lee Sales' work on 7:30 last week was extraordinary as well. It's people who haven't seen those, I'd suggest they watch them because it sort of gave me a bit of refreshed optimism about the standard of reporting. I thought the bigger problem is actually not so much the reporting during the campaign, and what happens in the 3 years in between. Because people, they tool up, you know, they put resources on to do the campaign and they do it really well, but then it drops back to page 5 and page 7 and, you know, the short articles and the 140 characters and the lack of analysis and the very narrow reporting. So I don't think there's a big issue in terms of the campaign. It's what happens in between, I think, is the bigger question.
Yeah. So let's cut to Chase Ben.
You better give Peter a go.
I want to ask you, you know, when you're reading another story about Julia Gillard's earlobes, when you're her chief of staff, and they're not talking about things like a national disability insurance scheme or some other national, you know, significant program, I mean, how do you manage that?
I used to write lists, Nick. No, as you know, I'm a relatively calm person. You do become slightly conditioned to that stuff, and you just get on with it. That's what you can do. Peter might want to reflect on this. The chief of staff role in the PM's office, you've got to deal with all the bits, so the media and comms and the public-facing stuff's only one specific aspect. And particularly in the in-between, it's not just the politics, it's also the governing, and governing itself is a pretty big job. So you just get on with the tasks of the day and don't spend too much time reflecting on earlobes or anything else.
Peter, managing the pack, feeding the chooks?
I don't mind those what I'll call sort of social questions that come up around the edges, because that's the colour and movement of campaigns, and that's where I think people try and get a fix on the leader, their background, their family. The authenticity can come through with some of those things in a way, I guess, that the hardened Canberra pack doesn't really, they're not there to expose that. I think my frustration comes with the lack of policy, genuine policy debate that occurs. Yes, inside elections, I think it's missing. It certainly has been on the decline, in my experience, since the 90s. But more importantly, in that three-year period, there's a handful of journos in the gallery that if they called the office wanting detail in a particular policy area, defence, social policy and others, you'd think, well, that's bloody serious and we better get in caucus before we go back with a response or set up a sit-down interview. And there are others that would send through questions and you think, well, they haven't even read the document, they certainly weren't at the press conference, and I don't think they even have a sense of how the funding constraints with hospitals might work or the detail on the NBN. So I understand the pressure media is on. I'm sympathetic to the pressure with the 24-hour news cycle and cost squeezing that's happening, driving a lot of the stuff into the online environment. So the journalist that used to write for the paper the next day is now constantly updating throughout the day. But I think the quality of debate is lessened when we're not putting governments, particularly governments, under pressure about the cost of programs, efficacy. We're throwing money at all of these things, and where is the assessment 2-3 years down the track to say, has that money landed? Is it effective? Are we seeing outcomes on the ground? Because I think we're all prepared to spend billions in these areas, but we want to see results, and then the follow-up isn't there. So I hope, you know, I'll call out Patricia Carvelis, who I think is one of the best social policy journalists in the country. If Carvelis called, it was a serious call, and 2 years down the track, she would follow up on that initiative and hold you to account, both sides of politics. And I think that's what I hope we keep going in the country.
Thank you. Turning to electoral issues, and I think we need a political scientist to help us with this next one. So, you know, opinion polls keep telling us that Australians hate minority government and have no time for hung parliaments. And yet if you look at Australian voting behaviour, we are increasingly likely to elect hung parliaments and have minority governments going forward. What is going on, Andrea? What does the future hold?
Yeah, it's an interesting one, Nick, and I think we need to look at other similar comparable democracies, and there's similar trend lines going there as well, and that is that public trust increasingly is going down when it comes to our political representatives. But having said that, it's also going down when there's annual surveys about how much people respect the media. And so I think that's more an institutional thing, that the institutions that people once held dear in maybe the 1960s or the 1950s, as we've become more individualistic in our lives and less about collectives, we've got less faith perhaps in some of the institutions around us, and that would include churches too. So that's one thing that's going on, this decreasing public trust. And then political parties have got time, they've got a media cycle that they need to respond to. The media cycle, as Alan's pointed out, is very fast in terms of the reporting right throughout the day, putting things up online. A message can go out and it only takes one tiny thing to disrupt that message, and suddenly they've lost the clean air for that for the rest of that day, and it becomes about the gaffe or about some unintended consequence. So it's a pretty tall order for politicians to be able to deliver constantly what they're being asked. Commentators such as Ross Gittins would say that politicians losing trust because they're not keeping their promises. But the international data, including some studies we've done in Australia, doesn't necessarily back that up. And it might be that very high profile promises get broken, and that's what we remember. But in terms of across the board, when parties make their pledges, by and large, they do their best to try and fulfil those, which is called promissory democracy. But because there are the high-profile ones that get repeated again and again, it creates a perception that promises aren't kept, which again feeds into this cycle of a lack of trust.
I mean, there's some very good points there. We also know from political surveys that the electorate is getting more volatile. They change their mind more often. They change their vote from one party to another. We also know that the electorate is becoming more fragmented. So, you know, in the same way as media markets are becoming more fragmented, consumer markets are becoming more fragmented, political voting behaviour is becoming more fragmented. People are choosing between multiple different parties. Exactly right.
I mean, Queensland was a state where they, where the Labor parties were reduced to a netball team and then won the next election. Yeah. That was an extraordinary turnaround. And they're so volatile in Queensland. There's only one seat in the entire state that the Labor Party has always held, and it's the seat of Rankin. So that volatility is more so in Queensland than anywhere else. But when you've got a situation where you've had... we've had about eight bumpy years now, really bumpy years... Mm-hmm. We haven't seen anything like it since perhaps the late 70s, and it's probably worse than that, and four prime ministers in the last 3.5 years, and that's coincided with a global trend against the system and against the institutions. So is it any wonder that one poll showed that 28% of people in this election plan to vote for someone other than the major parties?
So what does this mean in terms of governing? I'm interested to hear people's ideas. Volatile electorate, turn on you at the drop of a hat, fragmented. I mean, is this changing the way governments go about governing?
I reckon there's something to be learnt from the from Brexit. You know, think about Brexit and join the dots. So the people know the north of England. These are traditional Labor constituencies, like they're safe Labor constituencies, and they all voted for Leave. They turned up and they voted for Leave, and it's one bit of English politics I know quite well. And I thought about it and I thought, well, these are working class people suffering firsthand from economic change and a lack of control. And they've gone, well, bugger it, I want to have some control. Not quite sure what it means, but this is something I can do. And people reaching out to Jeremy Corbyn, to Nigel Farage, to Donald Trump, to Bernie Sanders, I think there's a thematic there which people are only starting to understand. Compulsory voting changes the situation here in Australia. Does it change it completely? I don't think so. But maybe if you think back to Queensland, so it wasn't just the last election, but think about One Nation in that Queensland election where they got 13 MPs, just like that. Think about South Australia with Xenophon this time, but hang on, Steele Hall and the Liberal movement had a huge impact on that state. So maybe there's cycles as well. But I do think we are seeing a politics of insiders and outsiders emerge, and some very grumpy people in the electorate responding to that.
Thanks, Ben. Peter, is it getting more difficult for governments to get tough but necessary things done?
I think it is, and I think it will be like that for some time. And I completely agree with Ben in the sense that the traditional Labor vote, the traditional Liberal vote, in the case of Britain, the Conservative vote, doesn't necessarily align the way it used to align. And people are aligning to causes, not necessarily party ideologies, because it used to be, if you ask people what do the Liberals stand for, people had grown up in families that were Liberal, or they certainly knew the arguments for one side of politics. Same goes with Labor. And Labor voters, you know, raised Labor, died Labor. They never swapped teams. You have much more movement across the voting inclinations now than ever before. And you have around the world people moving votes like Brexit. The argument to stay was economic. The reason to leave in the end was social. And no one was prepared to really address the arguments that dealt with those social issues in order that you could argue to remain. I mean, the argument to go was strongly social, but there wasn't a counter to remain that was strongly social. And I think in Australia, because we dealt with immigration as a country over the last 20 years, we've certainly had that debate whether you line up on one side or the other of the major parties, or indeed not with the major parties. Australians feel that their concerns or their angst on these issues has at least been heard. There's a ventilation of the issue. What happened in Britain is they don't feel there's been a ventilation of the issue, and similarly with Sanders and Trump, the same thing happens. Now, the other important point to make is there's been two big changes in Australia. Lack of wage growth, real wage growth. I think that's going to play out in the next sort of 10 years, certainly the next term of Parliament. And the capacity of the government to manage the budget into a situation, it's not going to get to surplus anytime soon, despite what everyone says, but manage it into a situation where you have residual reserves to weather another shock, because it's the uncertainty that people feel around the world, here and overseas, that is driving some of this dissatisfaction with the major parties. And when they can't control out here and throw terrorism into the mix, they go really home and hearth. And one of the things they can control is their vote, and they're quite prepared to walk in a way they haven't been.
Thank you. Well, that's the end of the warm-up questions. Now I want to throw it open to the audience. So please raise your hand if you have a question. And we have Heath on this side and Aaron on this side. Might start at the front here. Helen?
Thanks.
And just introduce yourself as well. And remember, please keep your question short. No statements, just a question.
Helen Zoki from Oxfam here in Australia. I think my question is probably to Ben and to Peta, picking up on the comments you just made about disaffection and about people feeling as though they're not being heard. Obviously, there were many issues in this campaign that didn't get any airing. Obviously, from my perspective, issues around overseas aid, issues around Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities didn't get much of an airing. And I think my question is, how do you think, you know, that re-engagement with the community about things that they care about can be brought back into play? Particularly, I suppose, whoever gets into government has got a whole lot of people who feel like they haven't been heard. I mean, there are a million other issues. Disability didn't get a mention. Employment didn't get much of a mention. It's all this kind of aggregate, macro kind of view of the world. And as you said, Peta, very much kind of driving it back to home and half and not looking at what the role of Australia is in the world. So what's the lessons? What's a bit of pro bono advice for those of us that are in the advocacy community for the government coming in, and how do we lift our head?
I think that's one where if the issues aren't predominant in the campaign, and there'll be strategic reasons why either the incumbent doesn't want the distraction from their strategy, because campaigns are all about the strategy, tactics is peripheral, or why the opposition decided to play on different ground, again, to cut through, and you can see with a very disaggregated market, you've got to have a tight block of messages. The chance for those sorts of issues that people are concerned about, but they're not forefront in a campaign, is to run them over the next 3 years. So use the time of the Parliament, and indeed other legislation that goes through, and the ordinary budget cycle. So don't knock on the door in February and March. So often people would come and knock on the door in the week of the budget and say, we've got this great idea to be funded, and we'd have to politely tell them that the money was signed off in October. You've really got to get in early and have that conversation. And there's just no substitute, I think, to building a long-term relationship with both parties, and indeed as many in the Parliament as you can get in their ear, over that three-year cycle and have movement that way.
Can I just add to that? I've been involved with Vote Compass. Melbourne University has been the academic sponsor of Vote Compass, and ABC, obviously, the media partners. And one of the things we do is we ask people to nominate what the most important issue is to them. And we did this in 2013 as well. And the types of issues, while important to many people, are consistently the economy, health, education, environment in the top four, and asylum seekers perhaps, and that moves around a little bit, but they remain the most prominent issues that people put up there without being prompted of what they're going to put up. And I'm sure the political parties know this too, with their focus groups and their polling, and they know what issues are the ones that people en masse care about the most and direct their campaigns accordingly.
You mentioned asylum seekers. It's the nature of the debate around asylum seekers, and that's what's gone missing in this campaign. But let's accept that broadly speaking, for the sake of the argument, you accept the argument that to prevent the drownings, then you support turnbacks and you support offshore detention. But within that, why can't we have the debate about whether or not the people caught up in this are treated with a bit of care and with a bit of humanity? You can support both major parties' policies, but still run an argument that we are cruel to the people once they're in offshore detention. When Malcolm Turnbull was asked about this on Q&A, and he was asked the question, how did you feel when you saw the self-immolation? And he said, it's a terrible abandonment of hope. Now, if that's the view of the Prime Minister, that these people have abandoned all hope, and then say, but it's not our responsibility. We might have rounded them up and dumped them there, but it's not our responsibility any longer. Why can't we have that debate? Because these people's lives are being ruined. They are not Australian. They're mainly Muslims, let's face it. But it's time we had a debate around that.
Just to add three things quickly. The first one is there are important issues that are really important to a smaller number of people. I did a piece, sort of at the only time I've popped my head up during the campaign, I did a piece for the Election Watch website about the Institutional Abuse Royal Commission and the need for a national redress scheme. This is not, you know, something that's on everyone's desk, but for the survivors concerned, people around them, it's a really important thing. The second one is, I always give people the example of the NDIS about big change that takes a while and involves a lot of people. And that's a great example of something which, you know, 3 years preceding, everyone would go, oh, it's too hard, it's too big. But just those, the folk involved in that campaign worked and then did the tipping point in terms of bipartisan support and embedded in the budget. And then the third one I think is probably the most significant is mandate is a really important thing. That if you want to make change and you want to do it well, then put it up as an election policy and get elected. And that's a different debate on reform than things that are done mid-term. Doesn't mean the Senate's going to agree, but I think the importance of mandate shouldn't be lost in these discussions.
Thank you very much. Erin, got a question over there.
I've heard a lot of people say in this election, especially a lot of older people, that the major parties haven't been putting forward a vision for Australia and that they've instead resorted to a lot of micro-announcements and micro-policies. And being a young person and having only seen a small handful of elections where I was really paying attention, do you believe that the vision being put forward by the major parties is less powerful than it used to be in previous elections, or is that just more political pessimism?
Who wants to lead off?
Well, in my view, it's not so much about the vision thing. People always complain about and they say that it's not there. And the other thing that they complain about is that there's no real differences between the major parties. And this time around, I think that's just not true. There are differences. It really is the old, the classic Capital versus Labor campaign in many respects. It's Malcolm Turnbull playing the traditional conservative approach on managing the economy against Labor saying you can raise taxes and improve services. So that's the one big difference. There are differences on health. There's differences on Gonski and education. There are differences on the NBN and on climate change. So I think this time around that's one complaint that we can't make. But look, the vision thing is always missing. What's the vision thing? Maybe it's talking big about infrastructure or something and, a fast train. But those sorts of things are just not there anymore. But I do accept that I think people lack a bit of... they're just not inspired in the way that they would like to be.
Any other panellists want to talk about the vision thing?
I've got a little list.
I've got a little list. So I was pondering this afternoon. I've got a very good research assistant and I said, look, go through the sitting member websites for Lyons and Corangamite and tell me how many local announcements have been made since the start of the campaign. So in Corangamite, the sitting member has made 20 local announcements, all with new money next to it, totalling $13.9 million. So that's since the 20th of May.
One a day.
And in Lyons, in Tassie, it's 28 initiatives totaling $19 million. Like, that isn't just pork, it's pork and bacon and ham. Like, it's just...
It's a whole butcher shop.
So I reckon if you're in those places, you'd see that every day. You'd just go, oh, it's just, you know, bit by bit by bit. So I think there is a basis to those concerns. But, look, I think Barry's analysis is right in terms of, you know, Proposition A and Proposition B. They are traditional views of the world. And I'd like to hear a Gettysburg address and a Kennedy inaugural in a sort of a 2016 Australian version, but I'm not sort of, you know, I'm not that hopeful.
All right, let's try and get through some questions quickly at the front here. Ryan.
Yes, Ryan's my name. Look, I don't want to fast forward through the rest of the election campaign, but I will. As sure as we're going to have a winner, we're also going to have a loser. I want to get all your reflections on how that person might fare and who might replace them as the new opposition leader.
Okay, straight to the chase. Now, no one's getting away with not answering this question. Andrea, we'll start with you.
Okay, so I was at a political science conference a couple of weeks ago, and the way we got to get to know each other was we had to answer two things. What was our favourite political TV show? And who did we think was going to be leading the parties in the next 12 months? And one of my favourite answers from a colleague of mine at the University of Sydney was that it would be Tanya Plibersek up against Julie Bishop straight after the election. I don't actually think that's going to be the case. I think if Bill Shorten loses the election, I think it's going to be narrow if he does, then I'm not sure we'll see him go straight away.
Helen? Oh, I'm just delighted that's come to me next along the line here. So, look, if Bill Shorten loses, this will be... They're watching me carefully here because we were analysing this, trying to work out. This will be the first time that that's happened under the new Labor leadership rules, which we think means that it would automatically trigger a leadership spill. So if that's the case, and if Bill only just loses, then he would argue that no one should stand against him and he would be returned. If he gets absolutely smashed, then you would assume that there will be a challenger to him and you would think there could be up to three who would stand against him. So then the other issue is if Malcolm Turnbull loses, you would think he would be replaced almost immediately. If Malcolm Turnbull wins but doesn't win well, then he's going to have a problem over the next 3 years as to how long he stays in that job, because we know what happens to prime ministers in Australia now. So...
I can give you one scenario, and I'm not saying this might necessarily happen, but one scenario where the winner might be the loser in leadership terms, and that is if Malcolm Turnbull wins but just and goes in a minority government, that means that Bill Shorten has won 14, 15 or 16 seats, his leadership would be safe, and Malcolm Turnbull would be gone. He'd be gone in 6 months because, of course, he would lose so much authority and credibility. I think they'll come at him anyway over a couple of issues. Over retrospectivity around superannuation, he's going to have to deal with that sometime down the track, because I'm sure there's a lot in the Liberal Party who are not happy with that. And I think he's got problems on the plebiscite as well, and that could one day impact on his leadership. So you could get that situation where the winner loses. I don't think that'll happen, but for Bill Shorten, I think he's got to get at least double figure. He's got to win at least 10, maybe 12 or 13 or 14 seats to keep Albanese at bay, and I think it is Albanese. And in Malcolm Turnbull's case, I think the test for him is to at least get the numbers in a joint sitting of the two parliaments, otherwise, of the two houses, I should say. Otherwise, I think there'll be questions over his leadership.
Well, exactly. Now, I think that's pretty tough. If you look at that, that's only 8 seats you can afford to lose. Before you lose the joint sitting, you lose it at 9. And that was obviously the rationale for a double D. And the risk with the double D, as you can see, is the quota gets halved. So a 7% quota, a lot easier for the minor parties and the ragtag guys to get up. So you go into a double dissolution in order to clean out the Senate, and you probably get a worse one on the other side of it. So that's the conundrum. And it's a conundrum for everyone who wants a workable government, regardless of which major party ends up running the lower house. So we all should be concerned if the Senate's unworkable. It doesn't necessarily follow, if you have independents and minor parties, that you can't work with them. But they're a long way away from being Greens and the Democrats that I had my first sort of time in the Senate. So in the Howard years, I had only worked for Senate ministers. So for 10 years, was involved in negotiations. And there was a level of responsibility that came with the Democrats and the Greens that I don't think we're finding with some of these minor players like Jackie Lambie or Glenn Lazarus. Now, I would think the difficulty Labor's got, let's assume Bill does well but doesn't win the election, and I think that's probably the more likely scenario because I believe the coalition is sort of coming home strongly at the moment. Going into that leadership race that they had is a free kick for the government. So for a whole month, they're scrapping amongst themselves and going around the country and a bit like the Democrat and Republican primaries, scoring points off each other. Then there's a kumbaya moment where we're all behind the leader again, and you've then made yourselves look ragtag and given the government all this time to settle in. So I think that's one of the downsides of those rules. But as we were discussing out the back, we can't even work out how they're actually going to work. So I think they're quite untested. If Labor was smart, I think they would reward Bill from having done well over the last 7 or 8 months, and certainly I think logistically run a good campaign, and they would keep him there. But anything in politics is no longer orthodox at the moment on both sides. So it'll be a very interesting 2 or 3 months, I think, certainly till we get Parliament back, and then we'll see the mood of both the caucus and the party room once the big issues hit the floor.
And for Malcolm Turnbull, do you think the magic number for him is that 8 or 9 seats that he needs to be able to carry the double dissolution bills?
I think one of the disappointments people have said is that we've had a double dissolution and we've had it over the ABCC with little debate about the ABCC, but if the Prime Minister is returned and they lose seats, that we've lost seats for an economic plan. We haven't lost seats for any great reform. And sadly in Australia, both sides of major politics are not under pressure from business for reform. And the reason we had this extraordinary 25 years of growth is reforms from Labor and reforms from successive Liberal governments. So over here under the Hawke-Keating years and then through the remainder of the Howard years, we are where we are in many respects economically because governments of both sides have been prepared to put a stake in the ground and argue an issue out and defend an issue and lose government over an issue if necessary. And we're losing ticker, I think, in Canberra on tackling some of these big issues. I think it's incredibly important because we're an ageing population. Our cost profile and everything we care about, health and education and infrastructure, is getting higher and higher and higher, and it doesn't look to be any sustainable way to fund it unless we reorganise our affairs. And you can have growth in the economy, that's great, but growth will not match up to where our spending's headed. So I think it's just so important that we have an open debate, and I think Australians are quite prepared to have that debate. They want to see their politicians step up with conviction and have that debate. But at the moment, we're so bloody poll driven. We see a poll, we drop the issue, we move on to the next one. And I think that's part of the level, that's part of the reason why there's this high level of disengagement.
Thanks. And Ben?
I've known Bill for, you know, over 20 years, and he's brought his A game in 2016. I think the Labor Party will reward that. So win or lose, I think Bill will still be there. And I think it's a pretty extreme scenario for Turnbull to be rolled in the next 12 months if he was re-elected as PM, and then if he's not the PM, I've got no idea, to be honest. That'll do for me. Yeah.
Okay, I think we're over here.
Hi, everyone. Luca, I work in educational leadership. I think my question speaks to the point that you made quite eloquently, Peta, on the sort of disaffection that is sensed now across most of the world. I mean, and you see sort of nativism and Brexit and Trump and everything that's been discussed really sort of rising. So my question is, in a highly managed, sort of very professional campaign, with such scrutiny, I mean, some politicians get such a hard end of the stick in some senses. How can we get that authenticity back into the narrative so we can see some of that courageous messaging to come out? Is it even possible? Because I think it's one thing to sort of recognise it. What can actually be done, if anything, to sort of try to turn the tide against this, the announceables like jobs and growth or the number of times that Trump can say China or whatever those sort of concepts are?
I think we have to let people fail a bit. I mean, we have to be prepared to not want perfect in our politicians. And I think that the more we drag down the... I'm not a politician, right? And I'm not going to run for office. But the more we drag down the political class, politicians as a class, the more we'll get what we get what we ask for, you know? And I think we have to acknowledge that on both sides of politics, I think people go into it for the right reason. There are, you know, handful of exceptions, I'm sure. Ben could find some, I could find some. But most people could do lots of other things with their life and they choose to go into public life. And now more than ever, there's enormous personal scrutiny on politicians. I think some of the level of debate on social media, I am not on Twitter and I'm not on Facebook. And I think that, you know, I wouldn't sleep well if I read half the stuff on there about me. But, you know, you want a discourse that's intelligent, that's engaged, that doesn't leave people behind. And some of those mediums are not like that. And we need to have the politicians take on these big issues and do it with integrity. And I don't know that that's happening at the moment.
And I certainly agree they should be prepared to fail a bit. But I think where Turnbull has gone wrong, and I know that the theory is that he lost the middle ground because he didn't... continued to promote issues like the Republic and gay marriage and climate change and so on. But I think that what happened to Malcolm Turnbull from January through to April is that he put up issues without any real conviction and was bound to fail. I mean, it's one thing to, I think, to put ideas up that you're really convinced with and you'll die in the trenches for it. And if you fail, you fail. But he put up ideas like the 15% increase in the GST. He floated the idea of the states striking their own income taxes. He talked about the federal government paying only for the private schools and the states looking after the state schools. And they all just went by the board after very ordinary debates. And so he built up this reputation of being a ditherer who didn't have convictions. And so I do agree that politicians should try harder. They should be conviction politicians and be prepared to fail. But that's not what Malcolm Turnbull has done. And that's why I think he's disappointed people.
Go to another question over the back, up the back, over your side, Aaron.
Okay. Given what is happening in the world today, we've just experienced a tornado in Britain against austerity and neoliberalism. It amazes me that the media actually is not picking up here the kind of destruction of, the kind of neoliberal policies that have been carried out and that are being played out by the right, which is, again, you know, xenophobia, racism. It's not picking up the destruction of research institutions, scientific research institutions. It's not picking up the destruction, for instance, of car industry. And it amazes me that people like, for instance, Turnbull have been able to get away with saying we are good economic managers when they are actually implementing these terrible neoliberal policies which have been destroying working people here in Australia.
Any thoughts on the future of neoliberalism? Ellen?
I got some thoughts on the car industry. These are the kind of stories that my paper writes about. We've had that on the front page, two pages inside, looking at what the future could be for the people who are losing those jobs. So I think we are looking at some of that. You're right that Malcolm Turnbull's got a slogan, which is jobs and growth, and that he's going for this trickle-down view as to how the economy is going to improve and jobs are going to come from that. But I don't think it's right to say the media completely ignores those things.
I'd like to give a challenging view to that, and that is at the beginning of the campaign we had Duncan Storer, who asked a question on Q&A which articulated some of those positions about neoliberalism and where tax cuts should be in society. Should they be at the top end of town, should they be at the bottom end of town, or somewhere in the middle? And that man was absolutely castigated in the media for putting forward that viewpoint, and he was really just doing his democratic duty to be informed, to ask questions of his politicians, to get an answer in return. And instead there was a three-day campaign in the media against him, trawling right throughout his life. And he was trying to open up this dialogue and it got shut down. So what sort of message does that send to other people who might be prepared to put their hand up or their head up and to speak to those issues?
Facebook, Twitter, Kathy, Molly, do we have any questions coming in?
We have one from Twitter, and this actually relates to, we had a great article on Election Watch last week about our political scientists here, their favorite political TV show. And this question is, what are your favorite political TV shows?
That's a tough one.
Oh, I think I need an answer from everyone on that one. Come on.
Well, I'm into a Hobbesian-type world of every man against every man, so I'm nominating Game of Thrones, where it's about it's about hardcore power.
Look, I confess I have ABC on the TV and Sky on the iPad, and for the last 8 weeks that's all it's been, but I can't wait to get back into Game of Thrones and House of Cards.
Sean McKayla for me.
Ooh, House of Cards, the old one, the British one, if you've seen that one, as well as, and I, look, I resisted watching the US one because I love the British one so much, but I love the US one now, so both of those. And look, if I want a bit of inspiration and realise that it's not as bad as I thought it was, a little bit of West Wing occasionally, the reruns are good. But and yes, Minister, because that's not far from reality sometimes.
If people haven't read the Michael Dobbs books, which are the original House of Cards books, they're great books, and Michael Dobbs, he's got a couple of other political characters which are quite good as well. He's a Tory peer from memory, Brian, that's right, isn't it? He's a Michael Dobbs, I think he is, but obviously that, he writes an excellent book. The bookends of West Wing, so the early years and the last couple of years.
And unique, you can't get away with this one?
I'll go for Borgen because those Nordics are just so good looking, and they've got a good progressive left-wing political system as well. Okay, question up the back there.
G'day, I'm George, and given the ageing population in Australia, to secure a strong future for Australians, young people, should the youth vote be weighted to ensure that there's success in Australia beyond the next 30 or 40 years?
Okay, this is a question about, should younger people be given an overweighted vote, given that they're...
An equal-weighted vote.
Oh, an equal? Equal?
Yeah, give the ageing population more of an equal-weighted vote.
So if you're a young person, your vote counts for more because there's more of the future that you're going to see, is that the...
Yeah.
Radical. Good to see some radical thinking at the university. Anybody want to comment on that?
You've got to give women a... more weighted vote because we last longer and we're here longer living with the mess.
I certainly agree that they should have done that in the UK because the numbers show that people between 18 and 25 voted 62% in favour of staying. And there was one analysis that said at the end, so thank you, Uncle Barry, I really appreciated that one, but it was the Uncle Barrys of this world that actually voted for them to leave.
And the turnout for young people was half of the general population. So youth turnout was about 36 as compared to 72% turnout overall. So young people actually didn't turn up. And that's sort of half.
They had the franchise, but they didn't use it.
They didn't turn up.
36% turnout for young people.
Yep. So given we are at a university, I do want to ask a quick question myself about, on the behalf of young voters. So, it is true that many young voters feel like the system is no longer working for them, and they're probably right about that. You look at problems with home ownership and challenges in the tax system, what's happening on climate change, education costs, government debt. These are all burdens that young people are going to have to face up to because of mistakes being made by people now. But we also find that young people are increasingly disengaged with mainstream political parties, which are still the main vehicles of change in our system. So tell us, what is your advice to young Australians and the political system? Ben?
Turn up.
Yeah.
Look, I think there's... this is my one decent idea for the week, that... that think about the impact of MasterChef and those shows on cooking and how we're all now culinary cooks and, I want to buy those, certain ingredients, you can't get it. We need the MasterChef version of policy and politics. So reality TV goes through genres. I think we should actually do a reality TV genre on what good policy looks like and community activism. and actually engage with mainstream young people through that medium, because they all know the recipes from MasterChef. Let's change the conversation with young people. There's my one good idea.
Now you're on the advisory board of the Melbourne School of Government, Ben. We look forward to you taking that forward. Yeah. Peta?
I went to school in the States. I did a year over there when I was about 16, and I learnt civics as a subject like you learn maths in, like history. And at the end of it, I know how the very complicated electoral college works and can recite the oath and know that Betsy Ross sewed the first flag and all the other stuff that Americans sort of imbibe as they're growing up. And it always amazed me after 16 years of politics to go around, particularly with senators, and people would ask them what electorate they're from, and senators would say, well, I'm a senator for New South Wales, but yes, where's your electorate? Well, I'm a senator for New South Wales. And I know you're an educated audience of political scientists, and you know that if you're a senator, your entire state is your electorate, but a lot of people don't have even the fundamental building blocks about our democracy. And if you're going to have one woman, one vote, you've really got to make sure that you either are informed or it is an informed vote. So if you are not informed on a particular issue, whatever that issue might be, get yourself informed. And, you know, when I started in politics, the internet basically didn't exist. My first campaign, you had to move documents between states on hard disks, if you remember. No linked computers or anything like that. And I don't feel like I'm a dinosaur, but that's how much technology has changed. There's plenty of places where people can go and ask these questions now more than ever and become informed, because in the end, George, you know, you will inherit all the good things that governments have done, but you'll inherit the mess as well, if there is a mess. Let's say there is, and let's say the debt blows out and all of these things. You've then got to engage and own it now. And there was a report that Nick and I were talking about on Paul Murray, where there's a growth in the number of young people who vote informal, deliberately informal, and they gauge deliberately informal. So a blank ballot paper into the box. That's an abrogation of your responsibility, because if you want to moan, vote and own it. But if you don't turn up, like at Brexit, or you put in an informal vote, or you don't go and ask the tough questions online or in forums and inform yourself, then I think you lose your right to moan. And if you're going to inherit it, you want to own it.
Erin, I'm looking for you. Do we have a question on that side of the auditorium?
Lincoln once said that the dogmas of the quiet past are inadequate to the stormy present. He had a pretty stormy present to deal with. The post-war generation got told, rock up, we'll give you a house, we'll find you a job, we'll teach you English, and we'll integrate you. It didn't totally work, but I think it's been a pretty big success. The generation 70s got told, you'll get Medicare, you'll get free uni, we'll put you in a career for life, or as near as we can get to it. The generation today is told, rock up, own the debt we're making, we'll kick you out of a job 7 times in your life if we don't automate the job you have at the end of it, and we'll change the climate so the air you're breathing is hotter and, frankly, more or less useless as air. What's the 30-year vision we get?
Who wants to tackle that one? What's the 30-year deal for a young voter today?
Well, we've had enough problems in this campaign, I think, with 10-year vision. And if the vision built around numbers and the economy and trying to figure out where that's headed, then that's a fool's game. But the vision I think that you're talking about runs way beyond that, and that goes to the question we had before on a lack of a vision.
I mean, it is interesting that Nielsen's been doing polling since the 1940s in the US around the question of, do you think the life of your children is going to be better than yours? And the answer to that has consistently been yes for sort of 7 decades until the last couple of years. You've now got people saying no, they think the life that the children are going to live is not going to be as good as theirs. That is quite a profound turning point in people's thinking and attitude and optimism about the future. On that note, Heath, we'll go back to you. up to you.
I'm Hans Baer. 2015 was the warmest year on record. 2014 had been previously the warmest year on record. NASA says that the way we're going with 2016, that it could possibly be again the warmest year on record. And yet the two major parties, and perhaps even the Greens, haven't really given climate change much attention, despite the Paris conference and all that sort of thing. So what's going on? Why has climate change fallen off the radar screen to a large degree?
Who wants to pick this one up?
Maybe you've got two leaders that probably have progressive views on climate change, but because of experience the last 3 to 5 years, some of which I lived through professionally, they see it as a third rail, see it as the dangerous thing to touch during a campaign period. It may be on those big, bit like the NDIS, the way through to get a big systemic reform is to do the work outside the electoral cycle. Now, do we have time? Maybe not. And is it, you know, and obviously the scientists will tell you that it might be, you know, a bit late in the piece. But I think because of recent electoral and political history, there's a real reticence between the two leaders to stick their necks out too far on it. That's just a pragmatic analysis of where we're at.
And they're the wrong two leaders in this sense, that Malcolm Turnbull once was very critical of Tony Abbott's direct action plan, and now he says that it's doing the job. And that's a bit awkward and hard to explain. And Bill Shorten, on the other hand, fears that the moment he puts his head up on climate change, electricity bill, you know, the big new tax on electricity, and he hasn't put his head up, and that we haven't heard electricity bill through the campaign, and I'm sure he's mighty relieved about that. So, you know, neither of them are very on very solid ground on the issue.
I think you mentioned all three parties there, the majors, you mentioned the Greens as well. I think they campaign on what they think will get them votes. And so really it's a question, I suspect, for the parties and the politicians, but I think if they thought it was a vote winner for them, they'd be out there shouting it from the rooftops.
And I'll just make the bleedingly obvious point that elections are won in marginal seats, and if it's not top of mind in a marginal seat, when everything's concentrated down in a campaign to 20 or so seats, the campaign is driven by those seats and the issues that they care about. I'm sorry to everyone else if you're not in a marginal seat, but that's the mechanics of a campaign. I think Ben's point's right. Outside the campaign, we've just gone through the Paris conference, that's where you tend to get the longer term, I guess, more systemic changes in policy. But one interesting fact out of Brexit is it's likely to put pressure on the Paris Agreement and the cementing of that over the next couple of years with the withdrawal of Britain, who'll have to negotiate as a separate entity, nation state. It may change the configuration of the remainder of the Europe deal. So I think there'll be some change around those issues. And I do think, you know, likely at this stage you'll see Clinton, so I don't think you'll see enormous swings out of the US on this policy area, but if it went the other way with Trump, yes, you would.
Okay, thanks. Erin?
My name's Tess. My question is picking up on Barrie's kind of points about Malcolm Turnbull's perceived thought bubble leadership when he took over as Prime Minister. And I just want to know if the panel was surprised that Malcolm didn't have a strong and clear plan of policies to implement when he became Prime Minister, and perhaps how the campaign headquarters has had to deal with that perception. And adjacent to that issue, what the panel thinks about the Conservative arm of the Coalition's control over Malcolm, and perhaps how that will end.
I think there's a couple of questions in that one, okay. But Peter, I think I'll let you have a go at it if you want.
I think the danger of changing leaders is that governments or oppositions don't take forward a platform to the people. This is Ben's point about a mandate. Outline a comprehensive plan. It may not meet what people want to see as a vision, because I think oftentimes vision's a very subjective thing, but nonetheless, when you've taken a plan to the election, there's sort of broad agreement from the community to get something underway, and you've got a framework that you just workmanlike fashion go through when you're in government. The difficulty when you flip leaders, as it happened previous term and the term we've just finished, is they're in the job and then they're scrambling to pull together the agenda, because you may not want everything from the previous incumbent, but you're almost on a bound because that's the mix that they have then taken themselves to their electorates to get them into the party room in the first place. So you have that contest within a party. You also have no time to breathe and prepare. So one night you go to bed, you're not the Prime Minister, the next day you are, and everything comes at you. The machinery of government comes at you, security committee meetings, budget meetings. You're in at whatever point in the cycle it's up to. So you don't get a chance to say, hang on everyone, just give me 2 weeks, I'm gonna work that plan out and get it underway. You don't have that. And I think that has been shown both with the Rudd-Gillard-Rudd changes and the Abbott-Turnbull changes, that's where the disappointment can start. Now, let's hope that there is a plan coming from this election, whichever side wins, that then is implemented in a pretty methodical fashion. I think people want to see stability, and they want to see, yes, politicians can meet their promises, but I don't think they want to see the volatility in the election cycle either. They want politics to fade into the background so they can get on with their lives and get back to what politics used to be like 10 years ago.
And just looking at the other side of that, Malcolm Turnbull had enormous popularity at the time that he took over the leadership. And that's steadily gone down, as we know, according to the opinion polls. And so for Bill Shorten, that put him in a position where he had nothing to lose, really, but to put out a lot of policies rather than remain a small target, which is often what oppositions do. And so in some ways, we've had access to more of an understanding of what Labor policies are going to be, because Bill had nothing to lose to try and lift, I think at his lowest he was 13% in terms of preferred prime minister, and has brought that back up now back into the 40s, perhaps. And part of how he did that was to lay out what the agenda was for the Labor Party. So I think that's the opposite side to what happened there with Malcolm being hamstrung through the deals that he did in order to take over that leadership and not wanting to upset the factions within the Liberal Party.
Yeah, I think Andrea's right there. Bill Shorten he's the one that has to come from behind. So he's made himself a really big target. And it's Labor really that set the policy agenda here. You look, they were out really early on their negative gearing capital gains tax, $32 billion over 10 years. Whether you love it or hate it, everyone knows about it. And the Labor guys tell me that wherever they go, but that's really cut through. People know about it. So he's right. He says, I've not been a small target. And that's absolutely right, to his credit, that he's led that policy debate. So all that Malcolm Turnbull has had to do is not stuff up. So he's been a very small target. It's been quite hard to land a big blow on Malcolm through the last 8 weeks because he's just been low risk, small target. So if he has some grand vision, as someone asked earlier, or he has a great policy agenda, we haven't really seen it. He's just playing it really safe and trying to get through Saturday.
So when I spoke before about how Malcolm Turnbull had put up these kites and didn't land any of them, and simultaneous, Bill Shorten went after him on the GST. It started in a really dodgy way, but he broke off his holidays, went to Queanbeyan and he asked the lady to name her favourite lettuce, and the country laughed at that. But from that moment on, he really picked up momentum and he put Malcolm Turnbull under pressure on the GST and then simultaneously put up his own idea. And that was to get rid of some of the excesses around negative gearing. And that's lasted the distance. And he hasn't really been hurt on negative gearing. And I think that contrast has hurt Malcolm Turnbull a bit as well.
And if you think back to the states getting the taxation powers, that thought bubble, that was really, it was extraordinary. So Council of Australian Governments, it's a long process. Officials work for months on the agenda. There's thousands of bureaucrats that work on the papers for it. He just made that up. And I thought, that can't be right. And I rang up someone who was in the room. I said, mate, were there any papers with that thought bubble? Nah, nothing. Like literally a verbal thought bubble. It's quite extraordinary when you're actually in government and you've got the Federal Public Service, you've just, yep.
And the shame on that was we'd started out a Federation white paper process. So the first time we'd actually said, there's a lot of overlap, duplication, waste of your dollars between the state, the Commonwealth, and no one really knows who's doing this and who's doing that. And it was so overdue for a good look. And bipartisan, Labor and Liberal, around the table, state premiers of both persuasions, really treated it genuinely. There was a green paper, white paper process. There's plenty of fundamentals there that I would hope goes into the next term, because at the moment that's one of the big problems we've got if you want to talk about sustainability longer term, is this mess of payments and just people. For example, the health department in Canberra does not see a patient. The health department, 4,000 bureaucrats, basically checking that the money they're giving the states for hospitals and other things is spent wisely. That's not a great use of 4,000 people in Canberra, and the cost on just the checking is phenomenal. Could pay for a hospital. So that stuff's got to change. So the thought bubble that came in over the top of that was sort of like, come on, there's a great process there. We can't let that fail. We've got to keep going with it.
All right, I think we've got time for one more question. So lucky last.
Just a quick one for Nathan. A question for Peta. You spoke earlier about your frustration with the Senate when you were working with it. Obviously, it's a double dissolution election. We're all about to elect a lot of senators without a great deal of scrutiny of the work they do. Do you have any thoughts for how you would change, if you could, how the Senate's run or even how it's elected?
Look, when I started working in the Senate, there were people like, you know, Brian Harradine, who was a crossbench senator, formerly Labor senator, who had left. And he was very difficult to negotiate with, but you knew where he stood. He was a man of conviction. And I think he treated every negotiation very honourably. I think the criticism I would have had, and all the way through, so I did the negotiations with other people, other staff on the big bills that went through in 2005 and others when we got the Senate majority. I used to get a sense in the Senate that people wanted an outcome, and it wasn't necessarily aiming for perfect, because if you want 100% in politics, you'll never get 100%. You've got to be pragmatic to say, well, 80 is better than 100. And I think, to her credit, Julia Gillard, managing that very difficult Senate in the hung parliament, was able to get bills through. I mean, we supported 85-odd% of the legislation. What happened in the last parliament was there wasn't, I don't think, a willingness from the crossbench to even negotiate. And that made things very, very difficult. And I don't have much hope that it will improve after the election, because, as I said, lower quotas, very difficult Senate, I think. It could possibly be a month before we know the final makeup. We haven't tested the new voting rules, so it depends how quickly the preferences exhaust. And the government's got a big agenda, all governments do, but I'm pretty pessimistic, I have to say, about the Senate. I would much prefer it was amongst, yes, major parties, serious minor parties who want an outcome, as opposed to grandstanding single issue parties. That fragmentation, I don't think it does us any good. At a national level anyway. I mean, there are really big issues of state that are bipartisan, that move from Labor and Liberal in continuity. And if that stuff's mucked around, it's long-term damage.
All right. Now, just as you do on Insiders, Barrie, I'm going to call for final predictions about the Australia's 45th Parliament, because one thing we do know after this...
Just an observation and not a prediction.
Observation and a prediction, if you like. So what can we expect from the Australia's 45th Parliament? Andrew, I'm going to start with you again, and we're out of time, so please make it quick.
Okay. There's a reason I don't do footy tipping, because I'm no good at predictions at all. I think that the unrest we've seen with four prime ministers in 4 years is perhaps not a cycle that's left us yet.
I'm going to be even less courageous than Andrea and say that I think it's going to depend on the makeup of the Senate as to how complicated things are, and it's going to depend if they get enough, whoever wins, if they get if it's Malcolm Turnbull, if he can get the numbers to get his double dissolution trigger through both houses. If he doesn't, as we discussed before, there'll be trouble. Either way, I think it's going to be really entertaining 3 years.
I think when you break it all down, the overwhelming attitude that I think will emerge is that people want stability. They're disappointed in Malcolm Turnbull, but they still figure that he needs a go, needs to be given a go, and he represents the best hope for that stability. But on the night, I think you might dismiss the prospect of a Labor winning outright fairly early on, but I think the audience will stay with us. because they want to see whether Malcolm Turnbull can stay out of minority government, can win in his own right, and then they'll want to see whether he gets the seats that would win a joint sitting of the two chambers. So it'll be a fascinating night.
I think the government will be returned, but I don't know how comfortable that return will be. I don't think they'll get the joint sitting numbers, would be my read, but they're moving pretty hard. The numbers are coming back to the government pretty hard in the last couple of days. I could be wrong, but my gut is they're not going to get that, because that magic nine we talked about includes the Senate, and I think the volatility really is in the Senate than the House. There'll always be some surprise wins, holds, and losses. So everyone that says they know what's going to happen on Saturday night, the one thing you know is they don't know. No one knows. Some incumbents in really tight seats will have worked really hard and they'll hold, and others that should have held will go under because they've sat on their backside or they've played the Canberra game for the last 3 years. And I think that if the government is returned, I would hope we see stability in the Prime Ministership. I know the current Prime Minister profited from instability to get there, but I think in our country's interest, we need a government to hold the term and we need a Prime Minister to be in the job. I would love to have a conversation in the community about four-year terms, because I think 3 years at a national level is just far, far too short. No company worth its salt plans less than five, and here we are turning the ship over every three. And so when you're watching Barrie, you can flip over and watch me on Sky on Saturday night.
Although, can I just say, the UK's got five terms, and now...
Five's too long.
And now Cameron's gone.
After less than a year of the election.
Ben?
I reckon that it's likely that the coalition will dip below 76. I think we'll be in minority government territory. I think there'll be a bigger crossbench, and I think there'll be big state-to-state variations. So... particularly Queensland and WA, there'll be some strange things happening there in the nicest possible way.
Can I just make a quick comment about Victoria? Sure. Just a quick comment about Victoria, seeing we're here in my old alma mater and Nick's alma mater. Barrie made a really good point about Queensland. So Queensland is a really volatile state. When it swings on in Queensland. Victoria has only had four seats in the last 10 years that have changed hands. So we've got a lot of focus on Victoria, and we're obviously, everyone's talking about this CFA issue. You've only got four seats that have changed hands in the last decade. Three of those were won by the coalition at the last election. I don't think the coalition's in danger of losing any of those three. And I think the fourth one, being McEwen, held by the Labor Party, is probably likely, even with CFA, to stay with the Labor Party. So the race isn't a Victorian race. It's very much New South Wales and Brisbane, and obviously the Xenophon factor, I think, will be interesting on the night.
One final observation on Victoria. There's a real prospect that Darren Hinch will be elected, and he's ineligible. He's ineligible. He's been convicted of an offence that carries with it more than a year in jail. That makes him ineligible, and yet he could win the seat. If he does, he's then susceptible to a High Court challenge. It'll win. That challenge would succeed. The whole of Victoria could go back to elect the 12 senators again. It happened in Western Australia, and it could happen here. So look forward to that one.
Please, thank you. So. Just finally, I mean, people say that Australians aren't interested in politics anymore, and here we are on a cold Melbourne winter's night, and there's a couple of hundred of us that have all got together to have, hopefully, what you'll agree has been a robust and informative discussion. So please give yourselves a round of applause for your interest in the Australian election.